Welcome to Ask GMBN Tech. This, of course, is our weekly Q&A show. You get to ask mountain bike tech-related questions, and hopefully we give you the answers you're looking for. If you've got any questions, get them into us at hellotech@gmbn.com. The address is right there on the screen. Or alternatively, you can ask them in the comments below where we pick up that discussion. Make sure you use the hashtag AskGMBNTech so we can find out which ones are directly related and which is just general comments. Okay, first up this week is from Fakas77X. Why do riders use knobbly tyres for urban downhill races, seeing as there's no dirt to dig in? Wouldn't less knobbly tyres be more efficient? Yeah, you're kind of right, they would be more efficient, but don't forget that urban downhill race, it's a downhill race, yeah? So that is the key to the answer to your question, really. So most downhill tyres have extremely thick casing, and most semi-slick tyres do not. So that will be the first part of the answer. As for the rolling fast thing, it's a gravity focused event. So really traction is the single most important thing, both for the cornering and for braking. So that's what the riders have to compete against. And they're gonna be on a variety of different surfaces. So it might be urban, but you're still gonna get dirt. You're gonna get some rough alleyways. You're gonna get shiny cobbles. You're gonna get all sorts of different textures. And because of that, actually the knobble most part is actually still king, because it does offer the increased grip on multiple surfaces. I mean, there are exceptions. Blake told me about some of the stuff out of Valparaiso that he said there was just literally no grip. It almost didn't matter what tyres you're on. Some of the surfaces just had that sheen, and there were lots of crashes, in fact. But the point is, there isn't really an ideal tyre for it. Now, when it comes to specific downhill focused tyres that are faster rolling, Maxxis make one called the Minion SS, so that's their semi-slick tyre. It has the same shoulders as their Minion tyre, so really beefy square shoulders for like cutting an edge. But the top tread is much more like a file-based tread, so a lot faster. But being faster, it also means it has a lot less traction. And the types of place you need the traction on an urban downhill track quite often will be perhaps speed control on steps and rough terrain. You know, all right, so you have more contact with the tyre that in theory could give you more grip to slow down. But let's also not forget that if it's on the back wheel, which is where you would typically run that tyre, you've got less weight on that, so it's gonna skip around more anyway. So actually a knobble tyre, if there's any sort of edge that can cut into back of a step or in between cobbles, it's gotta be a good thing. But it's a rider preference thing as well. And let's also not forget one more thing, just to add into this confusing mix of things, is the sponsors of the rider. They might not make a particular tyre like in a semi-slick variety. I referenced that Maxxis one, Schwalbe make one called the Rock Razor. WTB make one called, Riddler, I think it's Riddler, and Kenda make one as well. It's one of their Hellcat combo tyres. But not everyone's running those tyres, and it does take up a big part of it. And it's personal preference at the end of the day. Next up's from Hanno573. What is your opinion on the damping system on Bold cycles? I think it's good innovation and looks incredibly good. Okay, yeah, Bold cycles, absolutely beautiful looking bikes. The damping system isn't theirs, so basically they spec different shocks depending on what the frame is. Now, it was a few years ago now, I took one apart because I wanted to have a look on the inside. It had a DT shock in there. Now, it was on the Lincoln, which is their trail-based frame. Here's a shot of it right here, the actual one, in fact. So you've got housing on the underside of the down tube, then you access the shock through that. And those two links on the back that look like they're doing nothing, basically they are attached to kind of like a stub axle system on the inside, and that drives the shock that's hidden or housed on the inside of the frame. Really ingenious solution to keeping it all tucked away. And that particular one had a remote lockout on the bar, and you'd have to remove that panel on the bottom of the frame there to adjust the shock pressure and maybe set your rebound. But once set, you don't really need to change that stuff. So if you're into that sort of thing, it's fantastic. On their newer frame, the Unplugged, which I saw at Seattle last year, this is it. I've got to say, I think that's probably one of the best looking bikes I've ever seen. Not having a shock or anything on show and having geometry like that, I just think it looks fantastic. On that new frame, you can fit a piggyback shock in it, so there's a lot more options to you. So the damping system, as you're asking about, is really down to the manufacturer of the shock that's been fit to there. And RockShox Super Deluxe, that's a fantastic shock that's inside the Unplugged there, and the previous one had a DT Swiss, I forget the model of shock. It was a decent shock, but it would also house a Fox in there or a RockShox shock if you fancied that. So it's really down to what you spec on there, but man, they're beautiful looking bikes, aren't they? I love how all mountain bike experts always suggest to experiment with different stem lengths and bar widths, as if everyone has a bunch of different stems and bars just laying around to experiment with in the first place. How about some other suggestions or a rule of thumb? Thanks, Theo. Okay, well, that's fair enough, but what we do is try and give advice that people can understand easily. Okay, so let's just say, for example, you were looking at experimenting with bar width and you've got a bar that's 780. Okay, so granted, you can't just add on grip to that, but you could, if you've got lock-on grips, move them out to slightly wider position just to try it, to see if you like it. It doesn't mean you should ride them like that, that's not a good idea, but it does mean you could try it and simulate what it would be like. So that is involving using a wider bar without having to have one laying about, as you put it. Also, you could move your grips inboard as well on the same set of bars, so you could simulate what it's like to cut a bar down without having to actually cut it down. So that's just one way to experiment with bar width and stuff. Now, if it's looking at, say, going for a higher rise bar, it's pretty likely that someone that you ride with might have one, so maybe you should have a sit on their bike and just see for size how it might feel, roll it backwards and forwards if they'll let you do that in the stem, and you'll get a good idea of that. Now also, you might have some spacers underneath your stem, which means you could put your stem lower and put those spacers on top to take up that space and move it around a bit, so you can tweak that, you can play with that to get a different feeling in the cockpit. And of course, there is also the most important resource to all cyclists. Really, you're going to have some kind of local bike shop. Now, most bike shops, provided that you have given them some custom at some point, are there to help you. So what they will tend to have is a supply of bars and stems that they will use as bike fitting items. So let's just say a guy called Joe goes in to buy a Specialized Hard Rock hardtail and he's not sure about the bars. He says, oh, I want a shorter bar, I want a narrower bar. The mechanic could go and get one from in the workshop, fit it to his bike, be like, how do you like that for size? Does that fit you maybe? Like, is that your sort of thing? And he goes, yeah, but I don't want this one. I'm going to buy the one that's over there. But now I know what I want, I can go and buy that one. So it's fairly likely that your mechanic or your workshop in your local bike shop will have some stuff that you can go in and try out before you buy to make sure you get it right. So there is always a way to experiment with stuff. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to have a stockpile of stuff laying around. But use your friends, you know. Your friends are going to have slightly different stuff to you. And experiment, like I suggested, you know. Maybe run your grips in, grips out, that sort of stuff. Of course, that is just to get an idea of the position. You shouldn't really be riding with exposed bars or your grips poking over the end, because you're asking for trouble. Problematic one from Lee Hathaway. I've got a set of Fox 36 forks and I pump them up to 85 psi. Every week when I go for a ride, the pressure drops to around 30 psi. So basically there's some kind of slow air leak. I've changed the valve core, but it's no different. Any ideas what might be the cause and how to fix it? Well, first point of call, I would have said the valve core. And just to be sure, I would remove it again and reinstall it and just make sure it is in there tight, because it's only got to be a little bit loose for the air to leak out. Just think the same on your tubeless tyres. If your valve core is the tiniest bit loose, you certainly do lose pressure. Might not be noticeable during a ride, but maybe by overnight you're going to have lost some pressure. So that's definitely something to check. And you say you replaced it. I mean, they don't cost a lot of money. It might be worth just replacing it again just to double check that. I understand if you didn't want to spend out for another one again though. So you can actually recycle valve cores here, and you can take them out of Schrader inner tubes. Old shocks, if your bike shop, for example, might have a faulty one, you might be able to take one out of there without having to buy one. But yeah, so I would try that. I would also check the top cap, check the seal on it, make sure the O-ring that's basically holding that top cap in place and creating a good seal hasn't perished, because if it has, air could leak out of there. Otherwise, there could be a number of other little problems inside. Now, you say the air is leaking out, so it's kind of hard to get a grip of this, because there's quite a few things that can happen. Like I said, air could not be swapping properly. You can sometimes check this by basically removing all the pressure from the fork, inflating the pressure back in there again, depending on if you've got a RockShox or a Fox or whatever it is. There's always a slightly different way to make sure the air is transferring from that positive into the negative via the little port. As you do that, you'll know the fork feels great. The general sign of it not feeling too good is the fork will be incredibly hard. You've got to push on it. It'll be very easy to push it all the way down, i.e. it won't have a progressive curve. It will feel quite linear. That's generally when the negative has nothing in it and it's all in the positive, because it's not transferring. So almost the opposite problem to that suck down one. You could get the smooth end of a cable tie and very carefully just break the seal between the actual fork seal and the lower leg basically. You can just slide it in carefully, and sometimes when you do that, you pull it out, you can hear a little bit of as some leaking air that can be trapped in the lower leg has made its way in there and escapes. That can sometimes be a problem. Or it could be one of the other two things. It could be a slipped O-ring on the inside of the air tube, on the inside of the fork, or a perished O-ring, either of which could create those sort of problems. Sorry, it's kind of hard to specify exactly what it is without sort of seeing it myself. But generally, they're not like anything that's going to cost you a great deal of money to do. It is possible to do that, and I'm going to do a fork breakdown video soon explaining some of the problems that do happen and how to alleviate that, basically based off this question, because I thought it'd be a good idea to show everyone. Sorry if it's too late for you, and I hope you manage to get it fixed up soon. Okay, last up is from I'm Ricks. Hey Doddy, I've got a YT Capra and it came with an E13 TRS dropper post, but the actual dropper is a little bit loose and wiggles to the left and right slightly. Is there a way to fix the issue? It does not affect the riding though. So I used to have one of these posts and I thought it was actual post rotating, but that's probably not what it is, because what I found with this post over time, give me 2 seconds just to take the head off here. The actual post doesn't seem to have the same issues that some other brands do with basically the post click-clocking side to side. So the old RockShox post, the earlier ones, basically they have like a brass key system and the keys are designed to wear out to preserve the internals of the post. As they slide up and down, they obviously wear out and get a little bit loose over time, so the post would develop a little bit of play. When you have a service, they replace those brass keys, brings them back to factory spec. But on the E13, I haven't taken the inside apart to check, but they don't seem to have that issue on them. However, the head itself comes loose, and if you take the top off and you look down there, there's a 10mm Allen bolt on the inside of there. And I found in the past, the head has come like the teeniest bit loose and you confuse it with the actual post knocking side to side, but I found it's the actual head which bolts on. It's not bonded on, it's not anything else like you'd see. I know that the Fox one, it's all one piece, for example. This has got an Allen key bolt on the inside here to bolt this onto the top of the effectively what's the stanchion tube. So check that 10mm in there. And I'll just get one off the shelf behind me just to show you like a on the inside there. There you go. So that's engaged on the inside there. You may need to clamp your seat post in a work stand or in a vise. Obviously, if you're going to do in a vise, use soft jaws on there. You don't want to damage anything. And there you go. That will hopefully be the end of your problem. There we go. There's another weekly Ask GMBN Tech in a bag. Hopefully, you've answered some of your questions and maybe give you some information that perhaps you didn't know. Now, over on GMBN recently, I did a video with Neil. I think it went up like a week ago. And we basically discussed about upgrading a bike or buying a new one, because it was actually something we were talking about in the office. We thought we may as well just video it. Now, I actually thought it was quite good. And looking through the comments, actually, I think a lot of you really, really liked the concept of that video. It was a bit more casual. We were just chatting amongst ourselves about, you know, he was bringing up some good points about when you buy a bike, you get everything new, you get warranty, you get that stuff. And I was basically selling him the route of, I think it's actually worthwhile spending money on your existing bike. You don't necessarily have to have the latest thing all the time. But I really liked filming that, and I think Neil did too. And the comments are pretty good. So what I want to know is, would you like us to make some more videos like that? And if so, what topics would you like us to talk about? In particular, I'm thinking here on the tech basis, you know, maybe bike geometry, or, you know, what's the fastest wheel size or whatever, anything like that that we can have a chat about. We might get the EMBN boys involved as well. Might get Mark Nashton on the channel, any of that sort of stuff. Anything that's informal and chatty that you want to know about, let me know and we'll make it. And if you want to see that video, click down there. Also, if you want to see Neil's pro bike, the bike he raced and unfortunately crashed out in Chile, check down there. As always, give us a huge thumbs up if you love the channel and love what we're doing. And don't forget to click, share and subscribe.